So hello to everyone. Dear attendees, Septadon team is pleased to welcome you on our webinar. And we are grateful to Professor Francesco Manucci from King College in London, who is specialist in endodontics and restorative dentistry, to being with us for this webinar. Thank you, Professor, again. Several organizational moments, please put your microphones on mute, and if you have any questions, you're more than welcome with all of them. You can send them through the chat. You will find it on your right-hand side. And in the end of the webinar, the professor will answer, will respond all of them. So, dear professor, I'm turning the floor over to you.
Thank you. Thanks very much, Irina. Thanks to all the Septodont team for the invitation. And thank you for all for being here. My name is Francesco Manucci. I'm the head of endodontology at King's College London, as you've heard. And this lecture has been prepared with the help of many other people, in particular Salia Niazzi, Kostas Ioannidis, Sanjukta Debbe, Raul Bose for the experimental part, and also Maria Malcandari, Richard Condon, Angelo Zavattini, Abdulaziz Baksh, and Federico Foschi for the clinical component. I also need to thank Josette Camilleri, which has worked so hard on these silicate materials and has provided quite a lot of information for all of us. So the first consideration to make is that silicate materials have been around for quite a while, and so we'll talk briefly about the properties of these materials, and we'll also talk about technical tips for single cone obturation using silicate sealers, and we'll also talk about results of clinical trials on the outcome of root canal obturation undertaken with these calcium silicate sealers. So the mother of all this material is MTA, and MTA is made, as you all know, of tricalcium silicate, dicalcium silicate, tricalcium aluminate, tetracalcium aluminoferrite, gypsum, and bismodium oxide, bismuth oxide. Bismuth oxide is the radiopacifier, basically. And this is Professor Torabinejad, who is the inventor of this particular material. And actually, very few people know that he did this PhD dissertation here at Guy's. So to be honest, now I'm sitting exactly where he was sitting back then. And this is the copy of his dissertation, which I've got here. So later I can show you this dissertation, which goes back to 1995. And the microscope that Professor Torabinejad was using is still around here. And these are the original slides. And at the time, this type of materials was really new, and the kind of information that was transferred to the dentist was, look at this. This is an apex of a tooth with a bit of MTA that goes beyond the apex. And you can see the bone and the ligament reforming around it. So basically, the message was, you see, this material is so good that bone can grow on it. And these are osteoblasts growing on the surface. Obviously, it was true only up to a point. Clearly, osteoblasts can grow on everything. But what Professor Torabinejad and Professor Pitford were trying to say back at the time is that basically these materials, they produce this kind of response almost regularly, almost in every case. And this is because they are extremely, as we say today, extremely biocompatible, and also they've got a very good potential for being bioactive. So obviously MTA then was surpassed by many other products, and we all have used, I'm sure, biodentin, and now we'll talk about calcium silicate sealers. But in general, these materials, they can be used for indirect pulp cupping, direct pulp cupping. They can be used for pulpotomy. They can be used for apexification and apicogenesis. They can be used for root canal obturation of permanent teeth. They can be used for filling of root canal perforations, retrofilling. So there is a very vast use of this material. So the perforation repair is one, for example, this is a case of a lower five, and you can see that the dentist went the wrong way. Here is a very calcified tooth. So what we do is fill the perforation and then backfill using glass ionomer in this case. And this is a recall a few years later. Apical surgery is also a good field for silicate materials. Classic case, two central incisors with two posts and a simple solution to an otherwise complex problem. So the question is, are these calcium silicate materials bioactive? What does bioactive mean, particularly in relation to dentistry or endodontics? So the definition of bioactivity is quite simple in our field. So we talk about materials which are able to form carbonated apatite crystals. So basically this material, they can promote the formation of crystals of apatite. And there is a long debate on this. No? Some people say, well, Portland cement, for example, is it effectively bioactive or not? So in this paper from Josette Camilleri, Paul Lambretz, Bart van Meerbeek, and a few other colleagues, they observed which actually this hydroxyapatite formation had been proven with Portland cement, mostly in vitro rather than in vivo. And when they looked at this particular tooth that was extracted, what they found was that actually, instead of having hydroxyapatite, they were finding calcium carbonate, which is a very different beast, because if you have calcium carbonate, you can still promote some level of formation of bone, for example, but the material is reabsorbable. So it's not exactly the same thing. So the evolution into the more new silicate materials started with biodentin, at least for me, and biodentin is made of tricalcium silicate, dicalcium silicate, calcium carbonate, zirconium oxide, which is the radio pacifier, a much nicer radio pacifier than bismuth oxide. And compared to the old MTA, it's a much more carefully crafted material. It's a very, very advanced material with a fantastic chemistry. The liquid is basically a polycarboxylate, and this is a surgical case, for example, in which the entire canal has been filled with biodentin. This is another case of surgery in this heavily reabsorbed apex. And a vast use of biodentin is in the field of pulpotomy, which is growing more and more these days. Some of you may have read the papers in which authors tend to propose the use of these materials for pulpotomy as a permanent treatment for cases of irreversible pulpitis, a much simpler and much less invasive, time-consuming treatment compared to a root canal. So how are these materials, including the calcium silicate sealers we are talking today, different from other dental materials? This picture that was given to me from Professor Pierre Colon many years ago is probably very helpful because it shows the comparison of the activity of a very common material, which is the glass ionomer cement, which sets via an acid-base reaction, forming a gel of calcium polyalkanoate, aluminum and salts, versus these other materials, which form a gel, same as the glass ionomer, but the gel is of hydrated calcium silicate and calcium hydroxide. So we have on one side a material which is really acidic, the glass ionomer, and on the other side, a material which is very alkaline. And in the setting process, which is more or less the same setting process we see in the calcium silicate sealers we will talk about, is a process which implies the release of an awful lot of calcium and OH ions. So where do calcium silicate sealers stand in this picture? This is a picture taken from a review published by Dr. Donnermeyer and another group of colleagues in Germany. And basically, they have collected more or less the majority, not all of them, but the majority of the calcium silicate sealers around. And the only one which I've used is BioRoot, to be perfectly honest. Obviously, very well known is this other one, which was the first one to come on the market. And is marketed in Europe with a different name from the American one and another different name from the Canadian one. So we can see the composition is somewhat similar. So for endosequence, we've got zirconium oxide, the calcium silicate, calcium phosphate, calcium hydroxide. For BioRoot, we've got tricalcium silicate, zirconium oxide, tricalcium silicate, zirconium oxide, and povidone. And similar composition are for the others. So if we compare Biodentin with BioRoot, so these are the differences. This is the BioRoot, which is basically a tricalcium silicate with zirconium oxide and a radiopacifier. And this is the first experiment we run comparing these four sealers that we have. So this comparison involves the total field, which is the European version of the endosequence, the BioRoot, the AH plus jet, which is a very well known epoxy resin based sealer, and the Tubuli Seal Express, which is a very well known zinc oxide eugenol sealer. So just to remind us, BioRoot is setting like this with the first step in which three molecules of calcium hydroxide and water are produced in the end. And if everything goes according to plan, we end up in a precipitation phase with the formation of hydroxyapatite. So that's the bioactive part of the reaction. And this is the first experiment we run, which is a very interesting and simple experiment, but it says us a bit of the properties of these four different sealers. If you look at the red line, which is the BioRoot, it stays alkaline from the first moment the setting starts up to 2 hours here and up to 28 days here. So this red line stays on the alkaline side of the spectrum for a month when the experiment finishes. If you look at the total fill, it's also very alkaline in the beginning, but it drops very dramatically at 7 days. So the chemistry is apparently similar, but actually the reaction becomes very different. So this material is not alkaline anymore from day 7. This other one stays alkaline and continues to release calcium and OH ions for a month. AH plus is basic at 15 minutes. So it's quite alkaline here, but then it drops sharply after 2 hours and stays relatively acidic. Whereas the zinc oxide eugenol based one, the Tubuli Seal, is an acidic material which remains relatively acidic, pH 6, throughout the 28 days. And so we talk about, this is a picture from Dr. Camilleri's work. If you compare the endosequence, which is the same of the total fill, with the septodon sealer, which is BioRoot, you can see that there is a very large difference in the amount of calcium released in favor of the septodon sealer. So this high release of calcium hydroxide obviously indicates a very intense reaction rate. And this is by all means an indication of bioactivity. However, we wanna put it, this is an indication of it. And it's not a trivial thing in endodontics, because obviously you've got materials which are really effective in penetrating into the tubules. So this is BioRoot, for example. You can see this is the canal, and these are the tubules. And clearly the material is capable of penetrating into the tubules very, very effectively. And the same is for the other sealers. They all penetrate into the tubules well. The thing is, if you've got an infected tooth, what you have inside these tubules is bacteria. We know that bacteria can penetrate quite deeply, not just in lateral canals, but deeply, deeply into the tubules. In the end, we have a sealer which penetrates into the tubules. These tubules in an infected tooth are filled with bugs. This sealer has got a very, very high pH and remains very high for 28 days. The result is that this sealer, in theory at least, should be able to kill bacteria better than the others. And this is effectively what we notice again in an in vitro experiment, in which we tried to use these four sealers to kill bacteria grown in a multi-species biofilm. So this image which you see on the right is the image of the biofilm, which is composed of five different bacteria, and Enterococcus faecalis and Streptococcus of some type, and also Propionibacterium acnes and a few others. And you can see that where you have red cells here, it means that the cells of the bacteria are largely dead. Where you see the green cells, it means that the bacteria are still alive. And this picture tells us the proportion of bacteria which have been killed. So for BioRoot, it was 46%, for Tubuliceal was 25%, 9% for AH+, and 29% for the total field. So there is a difference in favor of BioRoot in terms of capacity of killing bacteria, at least in vitro. So the first message from this lecture is that calcium silicate sealers, particularly BioRoot and TotalFill in this experiment, have a stronger and longer lasting antibacterial effect compared to the zinc oxide eugenol and resin-based sealers. This is likely to be associated with the long-lasting increase of pH produced by these sealers. And this increase in pH was longer lasting for BioRoot than for TotalFill. And this may explain the higher bacterial killing observed with BioRoot compared to the TotalFill, which is still a silicate cement. Clearly, there are many other aspects we need to look into. One is the radio opacity. Clearly, these materials are not the most radio opaque of all, but still, both EndoSequence and the BioRoot are quite acidic. This is again a picture from one of Josette Camilleri's work. And this is an interesting systematic review from Dr. Donnermeyer and Edgar Schaffer and other colleagues in Germany, if I remember well. And so they looked at the properties of the sealers, and clearly they highlight the advantage of having a material which is intensely bactericidal or bacteriostatic. And there is a concern in general for these materials that is associated with the fact that since they are so active and release so much calcium hydroxide, how stable are in the long term? There is a potential for not sufficient stability. So if you start thinking about it, you may think, well, in the very long term, they might end up shrinking and allowing a reinfection. So the solubility is a bit the doubt on all of these materials. This kind of questions, I mean, this kind of material properties, whether they are good or bad, at the end of the day, one has got to test them in a clinical context, because one property of the material, which is good for one aspect, may be bad for another, but it's the clinical use which tells us what's going to happen. So we've done, as we said, this study on the outcome of root canal treatments undertaken with single cone and bioroot obturation. Far from me to describe myself as an expert of single cone techniques, because obviously the technique which I use most often remains warm thermoplastic techniques. But clearly, since we went into this study and clearly these materials were interesting, one tries to develop a technique of his own. So what I do, which is not necessarily what my colleagues do in my clinical trial, what I do with this particular technique is placing the GP point to length in the master point try-in. Obviously, before we reach this stage, we've got to prepare the canal correctly. Most of all, we've got to prepare a correct apical stop. We need to get some tug back from this GP point. And then what I do, I deliver the sealer using the GP point. One feature of bioroot, which I think it's a positive one, is the fact that you do not deliver this sealer with a syringe. You can if you want, but it's not. It doesn't come in a syringe. And I prefer this, so I prefer to apply the sealer with the GP point for one reason, because clearly in this way I can manage to fill the body of the canal with gutta-percha. I can still manage to push the sealer into the tubules. And I've got some guarantee that there is not too much sealer at the apex of this tooth, which may create a problem with retreatments. Then, once I apply the sealer, I place the GP point into the canal. I cut the GP point with a cordless pack heater. And at this point, I've got a GP point which is more or less placed at this level. So it is occupying, let's say, the middle and the apical part of the canal. So I plug it gently with the plugger. There's no warm condensation here. There is simply a gentle plugging of the GP point. And then I fill the coronal portion of the canal with composite or glass ionomer, as you can see in this image here. So what about retreatments? The reason why I think this technique is good is shown by this survey, which was run a couple of years ago by Dr. Bouquet from Paris and his other colleagues. And what they asked to the different dentists was a number of questions on the use of the sealer. And one of the points that was highlighted, it was that a very large proportion of the dentists, around 55% of them, were concerned because they thought that if you use a silicate sealer, it may be difficult to retreat the tooth. And this is an issue which I think is much more related to the use of the syringe-based sealers like EndoSequence or similar, where you get into the canal with a very large volume of sealer. And clearly this may result in a problem in retreating the canals. But if you use the technique which I've shown, I've done one or two retreatments of teeth filled with single cone. There is only one case that was retreated in our trial, but it wasn't retreated by myself. These are retreatments of single cones and bioactive sealer from practice. So this is a dentist in practice which has done this, and certainly it wasn't a problem to remove at all. Similarly, in this other premolar, there is a missing canal. It's a single cone technique. The volume of sealer is not too much. The retreatment in itself doesn't pose any particular problem. Clearly, our comparison, my comparison, was in my mind with thermoplasticized techniques. So all the root canals you will see are prepared with this instrument, which is largely protaper gold Proteper Next, and more rarely Wave 1 Gold. And this is my typical obturation with the thermoplasticized GP. And this is a single cone bioroot. Clearly, there is an element of lack of radiopacity here at the apex, but you can see that the anatomy of this canal, which shows a curve, which is very interesting because it looks like it's going distally, but in reality, then it turns mesially, has been respected. And there is a small puff of sealer visible here. Clearly, if you use a classic thermoplasticized technique, you've got a more visible description of the anatomy. But the technique with a single cone bioroot doesn't mean that you can't respect the anatomy of the canals. And you certainly end up, at least in my hands, with a smaller number of extrusions compared to what you get with a thermoplasticized technique. So what are the clinical data that we have available on this material? We've got some work on the pain, on the postoperative pain. So the calcium silicate materials are known to be associated with less postoperative pain. This is an experience that most dentists and endodontists have in the use of these sealers. And before our trial, the only clinical study, which I could find, I'm not sure if I've checked the literature well, but I've checked it again recently, was this other one, which is basically a retrospective study from America. And what they did, they looked into their cases treated between 2009 and 2015. And they had a minimum of 1 year recall, an average follow-up time of 30 months. Clearly, it's retrospective with all the limits of a retrospective study, but the success rate with PAs is quite good, is around 90%. And these are the images they show. The problem with this kind of trial is that you end up always having results which are always in this kind of region, no? 90% success. The thing is, are these type of trials effective in detecting failure? So, for example, if you look at this image, it's a periapical radiograph of a tooth of a patient which comes into the surgery having pain in this area. There is pain to percussion on the 4, pain to percussion on the 6, pain to percussion on the 7, a strange feeling of tenderness of the maxilla. The bridge is recently done. Clearly, the periapical radiograph doesn't show very much. So you can take a parallax view, so you can try and move your X-ray beam to see a bit more, but still, you can't see very much. But if you take a CONVIM CT scan, as we did in this case, it's pretty obvious the problem. You've got a very large radiopaque area associated with the buccal roots of the 6. So it's a significant area of inflammation here, which pushes up the floor of the sinus. You've got a radiolucency on the palatal root. You also have some decay on the 7. The radiolucency on the palatal root is more visible here. And you also have a radiolucency on the 5. So you can treat these two teeth, redo the bridge, and 1 year later you are back to square one. Has it healed or not? Because you couldn't see anything before, you can't see anything now. So you need another scan in this particular case to check the healing. That's another example. Baseline and 1 year, it looks like this tooth, which had the radiolucency here, is perfectly healed. The baseline CBCT scan has a large radiolucency. The 1 year recall shows that there is healing. It is a much smaller radiolucency than this one, but there is still quite some time, some way to go, because you've got a residual radiolucency, which is completely invisible there. That's another example. This is one of my students' work. If you look at this mesial root, there is only some widening of the laminadura, which is equally evident in the scan. There may be some radiolucency on the distal, but certainly the mesial has got only some widening of the laminadura in both the PA and the scan. 1 year later, the student has separated the file here. You can see that. And that's the classic situation when people say, okay, I've cleaned well the canal. You see, even if the file has been separated, it has healed. Well, actually, it hasn't healed, because if you look at the scan, you can see a very well defined radiolucency here. Which wasn't present at baseline. So this is a new radiolucency which the PA is unable to detect. And the same for this one, again from one of my students, the baseline doesn't show any radiolucency at all. One year later, it looks like everything is fine. This crown was done by a referring dentist, but we can't see anything wrong here. But if you look at the scan, you can see that there was quite a large radiolucency at baseline. And 1 year later, it got much bigger. So in this case, we have an enlarged radiolucency that goes undetected with the PA completely. So that's why in this trial, we decided to use the Combim CT. And when you use the Combim CT, this is just an example, you do find a difference. If there is a difference to find between two treatments, for example. In this other trial, which is still unpublished, we are comparing the root canal treatment's outcome of teeth done by the same operator in 2010 and in 2018 with two different techniques, an old one and a more new and sophisticated one. And if you compare these two results, you do find a difference. But this difference, which obviously shows an improvement in the more recent technique, is only visible if you take a Combim CT scan. Because if you look at the PAs, you stand at a success rate of 87-90% in both cases, and there's no difference. Whereas with the scan, you see that we are growing from 62% to 78%. So that's why a scan is important to assess the outcome of root canals. Basically, this trial that which we run is a small, relatively small, in total we ended up recalling about 90 patients, comparing single cone bioroot versus the technique that we use every day, which is warm vertical. Actually, thermoplasticized techniques, maybe system bioptura, maybe Kutta Smart, and AH plus, so an epoxy resin based sealer. It's not randomized because it's the first study of this kind, and there's no real argument for putting into a complex randomized trial at this stage, because we need to have an idea of what kind of numbers are needed for a proper randomized trial. So when we say it's non-randomized, what we did with our students and myself was to let the operator choose the type of technique they prefer. Either it was warm vertical or the single cone for that particular case. And this is an example from one of my students, quite a large radiolucency on this mesial root. 1 year later, it's much smaller. And when you do the scan at 1 year, obviously what you do, you take three images to compare, the one in the axial, in coronal, and sagittal plane. And you compare them for each of the two roots, in this case, because it's a lower six. So this is for the mesial root, and obviously the radiolucency has gone down a lot, has reduced a lot. And this is the distal root, which is equally reduced. As you can imagine, it's a much more detailed observation of the outcome compared to what you can get with a periapical radiograph. And this is the study in general. So we started with 150 teeth. Clearly, 25 of them were excluded because 23 were unrestorable. Two patients changed their mind during the treatment. So we ended up with 125 teeth. When we ended up recalling them, 21 teeth in 18 patients, we couldn't assess them because they didn't come back. And two of these teeth, we didn't need to call them back because there was a retreatment during the year. But obviously they were included as failures in the final count. The end of the story is that we're comparing 51 teeth treated with DH plus and 53 treated with the BioRoot and the single cone. And the results, globally, the success rate is around 90% using periapical radiographs and is around 83% using a CONBIM CT scan. But as you can see, there is no real difference between the outcome. So both the single cone and the BioRoot, they did with BioRoot and the AH plus, they did work well. So the second message from this lecture is that this technique has a success rate which is comparable to the success rate that we did obtain with an epoxy resin based sealer and the thermoplasticized GP condensation. We can manage effectively BioRoot and single cone in limiting the amount of voids in the coronal portion, which was from my perspective, together with the doubts on solubility, the major doubt, because obviously you've got a single cone which is rumbling in a very large canal, but with the technique that I used, we didn't create large voids. Clearly, compared to the classic GP thermoplasticized techniques, you end up filling less lateral canals, or at least these lateral canals are less visible. This doesn't seem to affect the outcome. So going back to the survey from Dr. Bouquet and his group, what they were concerned is basically the retreatability of this tooth, and what they observed also was that there is a large variability in the use of calcium silicate based sealers. So some dentists largely use this with a single cone technique. So this group is the number of dentists using a single cone technique with a bioactive sealer, and this is the group of dentists that use the single cone with other sealers. So clearly, dentists that responded to this survey tend to use the single cone with a bioactive sealer rather than with another sealer. And the opposite is true for warm compaction. So if they use the warm compaction, then they tended to use another sealer. And for the practitioners, what they found is that it was the endodontist which tended to use this sealer with a warm condensation, which is something that is not advised by Septodont and also by the research undertaken by Dr. Camilleri and other people. Whereas the general practitioner, the GTPs, they tended to use it with a single cone. So what's the reason why it's not advised the use in combination with the warm technique? Well, the reason is largely because there is an element of faster setting with heat. So if you use these materials, BioRoot in particular, with the warm condensation, you end up having your sealer setting on the heat carrier, basically, when you do your downpack. So it's not ideal. And also, the faster setting might, at least in theory, limit the release of calcium hydroxide and the alkalinity created by the sealer itself. As this other work from Dr. Camilleri and Phil Thompson in Birmingham and other colleagues, Heran and Khalid and Albaji, is demonstrating. So these are some more examples from our trial. This is a thermoplasticized GP obturation, and this is a BioRoot obturation. more thermoplasticized GP, and more Bayreuth. This is Bayreuth in upper five, retreatment, and retreatment of the six. This is not from the study. These are just some other cases which have been done by myself. You see that there is a lesion on the distal root, and the lesion on the palatal root. And this is the final image. So you can be very precise with this technique. You don't get the image of filling deltas or lateral canals, but it's still quite homogeneous. I mean, there is clearly no void in this obturation. This is another from the study, one of my students, Bayreuth obturation of an upper six. Very good healing at 1 year. Also on the distobacal root. So in conclusion, what we can say about these materials is that we didn't find any difference. So if one is a general dentist or a specialist that like to use this, there is no reason why this technique shouldn't be used. It is a non-randomized trial, so with the limit of a non-randomized trial, that means that what you have is clearly a pilot study in a way, a bit more than a pilot study. You could compare it to a phase two study in a cancer trial, for example. But clearly, with this kind of numbers, so with this kind of difference, it's extremely difficult even to think about a randomized trial, because the numbers that would be necessary to find any difference would be so big that the thing becomes impractical in any field of medicine or dentistry. So this particular filling to sort out this concern about removal is not difficult to remove at all, because the amount of sealer which is left in the middle of the canal, and particularly apically to the GP point, is not as much as in other techniques. And another thing which is important to remember is that this retreatment issue is a limit for other techniques. So one of my students last couple of years ago went to America, an university in America, to visit for a week or so, and he came back quite shocked, because they were using endosequence there. And the suggestion was that if the treatment, the suggestion from the clinical teachers was that if the treatment failed, then they would go straight into surgery, which is obviously a complete nonsense, because neither in medicine nor in dentistry, if you got a treatment option, you don't want to be deprived of that treatment option. So retreatability is important, and this is probably a strong point for Bayreuth. The last thing to mention is the solubility. This is a 1 year study, so one may still object, well, if it's soluble, it could dissolve later. Well, actually, it's not that easy to say this, because in all the studies, clinical trials which have been done with all the root canal treatments in the world so far, there is not a single one which shows a significant number, or even a tiny number, of failures which develop after an initial healing. So what is an initial healing at 1 year has always become, in all the trials that have been done, a better outcome, a complete healing, or remained an incomplete healing at 2 years or 3 years. So clearly the 1 year result is extremely indicative of what's gonna happen later. If a treatment is successful at 1 year, it's not going to be unsuccessful at 2 or 3 years, irrespective of the material you are using, because this has never happened and it's never been shown. When a failure happens later, showing initially a healing, this is normally because a fracture happens, or the restoration is lost, or something like that. So actually this study, I think it gives quite a significant information for the use of these sealers. And I thank you very much for the attention. And if there is any question, I'm happy to answer.
Yes, and we have some questions, Professor. Can you hear me?
Yes.
So one of them, what is the modified heating technique does obturation consist of?
Modified heating?
Yes.
What do you mean modified heating? So I have my obturation technique is extremely simple, and it's not modification of everything, of anything. The one that I've used is a very simple, which is the one which I am showing here, is very simply, it's very simply the use of a single cone. So what I'm doing is just adapting the GP point and then cutting it off and gently plugging with the plugger. And that's pretty much it. So I'm left with a small space in the coronal part of the canal to fill, and I fill it with glass ionomer or composite. So it's a very simple technique which anyone can use. There's obviously no secret, and it's really something that anyone can do. I don't think I'm better than anybody else at single cone. As I said, I can't see myself as an expert of this technique.
Okay. Thank you so much. The next one, what is the final irrigation to be used with bioroot sealer?
Yeah, it's a very good question. Yeah, and very, very good and very debatable. I can tell you what we have done, and I can tell you the rationale of what we do with this. Clearly, you've got a material which you really want to penetrate into the tubules as much as possible. So if you want to penetrate into the tubules as much as possible, the best thing you can do is remove completely the smear layers, which is obstructing the access to the tubules. And this basically means that our technique is the normal technique we use for all root canals. So what we do really is irrigating with sodium hypochlorite throughout the treatment. And we do a semi-final irrigation with EDTA. And then it would be better if you manage to neutralize the EDTA with some saline. And your final irrigation, you want to be calcium sodium hypochlorite, because basically what you have is these tubules which you have opened with EDTA. So the EDTA has removed the smear layer, which is obstructing the access to these tubules, which are still filled with bacteria, if things have gone wrong during the treatment. So you've opened the tubules using the EDTA, then you want to kill with sodium hypochlorite the bacteria into the tubules, and then you want to do your obturation with the bioactive sealer. There are lots of people which think that the best final obturation is EDTA. To me, it doesn't make any sense. Normally, their argument is if you use EDTA as the final obturation, as the final irrigation, then you get a better adhesion of the sealer. We are not looking into any adhesive procedure here. There's no need for the sealer to adhere to the tubules. They are not going to come, no one is going to try and detach the sealer from the tubules or the obturation from the canal. So adhesion is not really an issue here, and it would be irrelevant anyway, because these materials are not as adhesive as one think, and most of all is completely irrelevant from a clinical perspective. So what you want to do is to try and kill the bacteria the best you can, and the best way of killing the bacteria is gain access to the tubules with EDTA, and then allow the sodium hypochlorite to go inside the tubules. Having said that, there is not a single paper in the literature, a clinical one, proving any difference of any irrigation technique, any difference between two different irrigation techniques. Whenever this has been done, no one has ever found any difference. So The question is still open, but my rationale is for irrigation with sodium hypochlorite, 3% during treatment, semi-final irrigation with EDTA to open up the tubules and remove the smear layer, and final irrigation with sodium hypochlorite.
Thank you so much. The next question, when using BioRoot RCS, does adding one extra drop of liquid affect the chemistry?
Well, I mean, the one thing I'm not is a chemist, so I can tell you that basically BioRoot, you can play with BioRoot a bit in terms of consistency. Clearly, you've got your ratio between liquid and powder to respect. Personally, and from a clinical perspective, I can't find any difference if you use this sealer slightly thicker or slightly more fluid. And this is something that it needs to be done clinically, because in a clinical context, you want to play a bit with the consistency of the sealer. Clearly, I'm assuming that there will be some interference with the chemistry, and if the doses are those established, is that because that is the kind of reaction you want to achieve. I don't think that it's a massive problem. I would avoid to have a very fluid mixture in general, because obviously I don't want to have a material which is more soluble than necessary, considering that in its normal fashion, this material is effectively releasing a lot of OH ions. Clearly, the creamy consistency you use normally in most cases is the correct one. But yes, obviously, if you reduce the amount of powder or you increase the amount of liquid, clearly the properties of the cement, of the sealer, will change. But that's the question you need to ask a chemist.
Thank you. The next one, is the only contraindication to using BioRoot with warm vertical technique an effect on the release of calcium hydroxide, or are there others?
It's very difficult to tell, because obviously this is a property of the material, and a property of the material doesn't constitute in itself a contraindication for the use of that material in a certain way. Clearly, if you use heat with this material, you do increase you do allow this material to set very fast. And this is not what we ideally want. So we want this material to be able to maintain an alkaline environment in the apical portion of the canal and in the tubules as long as possible. But this kind of question, if it's a contraindication or not, again, it can only be answered in a clinical context, because it would be extremely dangerous to take a conclusion based on one property of a material, because one property of the material is always associated with another property. So one of them is normally favorable, the other one is normally unfavorable. For example, if it sets too quickly, but then the material is too soluble, having it setting very quickly might help reducing the solubility in theory.
Thank you. BioRoot is a powder liquid formula. How the properties of such material is different from the premix type sealer, such as TotalFill?
Well, it's a very good question. Obviously, the premixed type of sealers, they must have an advantage because they are premixed. And so they always come out in the consistency which is designed by the manufacturer. Again, I'm not a chemist, so I can't tell you which solution is best from a chemical perspective. And we go back to the same answer before. The fact that two materials have got a different different properties, it gives us an indication of what you can do with it, but it doesn't tell you how to use it clinically. Personally, if I had to choose between a material which allows me an easy retreatment and the material which doesn't allow me an easy treatment, considering that the clinical results, they seem to be good in both cases, I would definitely choose the one that is easier to retreat. In terms of antibacterial activity, there is little doubt that the BioRoot is better than the endosequence, and which is the only one it has been compared with in terms of antibacterial effect, if I remember well. Although I think maybe Josette and other people may have compared it to other silets in the field of bio of silicate, but I do not remember them. Anyway, there is no clinical data on this, and the ultimate answer in these questions is always a clinical one.
Thank you. Can BioRoot, if BioRoot can be used, if BioRoot used as for pulp regeneration, as pulp cap, so how is BioRoot versus Biodantin for pulp cap to pulp regeneration? So what's the difference? I'm reading.
So BioRoot is a sealer, so it is not used for revascularization or anything like that. So BioRoot is used if you do a normal obturation of a tooth with a closed apex. So if you want to do revascularization of a tooth with an open apex, then you can use Biodantin if you want as a barrier in the coronal thread of the canal. That's absolutely fine. If you want to do indirect pulp cappings or direct pulp cappings or pulpotomies, then you use Biodantin, which is a cement and is designed for this. Biodantin is the one material you use for pulp cupping, pulpotomies, and for even revascularization techniques. BioRoot is a sealer and is only used as a sealer to obturate root canals with a closed apex, not with an open apex. So the difference is all the difference you may have. I have shown the composition is a bit different. So clearly the powder of Biodantin is different from the powder of BioRoot, but the biggest difference is the properties of the material. So one is a fluid material, the BioRoot, which is designed to be a sealer. The other one is a material which you can use even as a coar material. So obviously it has a consistency which allows the use as a perforation repair material, indirect pulp cupping, direct pulp cupping, pulpotomy, and that's pretty much it.
Thank you. Should we routinely use CBCT for pretreatment evaluation and follow up? If so, when should we take a follow up CBCT?
Yeah, it's a good question. Yeah, I personally don't use CBCT as a preoperative radiograph all the time. If I have a CBCT in the practice, I try and take the CBCT before the treatment of all molars, basically. Because for the front teeth and also the premolars, unless there is a particular problem, an external cervical resorption, an internal resorption, an anomaly of the anatomy which I spot from the periapical radiograph, if I don't have one of these situations, a trauma, obviously, if there is a trauma, there is external cervical resorption, if there is internal resorption, if there is anomalies of the anatomy, dense invaginatus, then you take a CBCT scan also for the front teeth and the premolar. Personally, I take a CBCT scan routinely for molars if I got a scanner in the practice, because it has been demonstrated that these teeth are the more difficult ones, and these are the ones you really want to know the anatomy correctly before you start your access cavity, before you decide which direction your files want to go, where your orifices of the canals are, if you need really to look for a second mesiobuccal canal or not, because you can tell from the shape of the root, you can't tell everything from the CBCT because the resolution remains poor, so you may still have a second mesiobuccal even if it doesn't show in the pre-op CBCT. For the recall, clearly you need to take the recall CBCT only if the patient has pain or problems you cannot understand where they come from, or if the image in the periapical radiograph is not clear enough to tell you if there is healing or not. But routinely, I wouldn't take a scan for all my patients at recall at all. These, I've taken obviously a lot of them. We've taken a lot of them because we run a lot of clinical trials. But one thing is the clinical trial. One thing is the clinical need of the patient. So that's my approach to the CBCT use.
Thank you. And maybe just two last questions. The one, I believe you replied already, but just to emphasize, because there is a second question about that. Do you think the Bayroot sealer's property will be harmed by the heat of the cordless heat carrier?
No, no. If you use it for cutting it, obviously not. You're just cutting the GP point. So if you use it with heat in, and you want to use, as some people use, I mean, these days there are other sealers which are designed for warm vertical, but I've never used them. Clearly, the properties are modified by heat. So, you, from a practical perspective, again, I'm not a chemist, but from a practical perspective, if you use heat with Bayroot, what you're going to get is a material which is faster setting. How much this faster setting can affect the outcome, we don't know. So that's my answer. Because, for example, if you look at the papers which talk about the effect of heat on sealers, then they would say that you shouldn't even use heat with AH+, but AH+ has been used with heat for 30 years. So we need to be extremely careful when people tell you, well, these properties of the sealer or of any materials, they tell you that this material is would be unsuccessful in this context. So they may be true, they may be right, or they may be not, because that particular material may have other properties which actually may benefit from the thing that they say is damaging. So if you use, if you cut your GP point with a heater, nothing happens to the sealer, obviously, because you just cut it. If you want to use a warm compaction technique with this type of sealer, it would set a bit more quickly and may not allow you to do all the things you want to do in the context of a warm vertical condensation. However, the outcome can only be compared with the outcome of a single cone of the conventional warm vertical with another sealer in a clinical trial.
Thank you. Just to finalize this topic. So Bayroot is a heterophilic sealer. Certain presence of humidity.
It does set in the presence of humidity. I've taken out the slide on the humidity. Basically, yes, has been done. Few experiments have been done on this. It's actually one of the strong points of Bayroot compared to EndoSequence. So obviously it takes a long time to set, but it does set much more quickly if there is a fluid compared to dry. But your Bayroot in 15 hours will set in a completely dry environment, say in the middle third of the canal or in the coronal third of the canal. If you leave dry the EndoSequence, it doesn't set at all.
Thank you. So actually, we are limited in time and we should finalize our very interesting discussion. And maybe just one more question. Let me check. Yes, I think they are all the most frequently asked questions. So I made a kind of summary of that. Thank you so much, Professor, for your interesting topic and presentation. Thank you all the attendees who found the time to be with us. So we will announce the next topic which can be discussed. So you're welcome next time and see you soon.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.